Ms. Shaver, in the beginning of your testimony, I believe you may have misspoke. Mr. Wiggs asked you when you were married to Mike Shaver, and you said May of 2016. When did you get married to Michael Shaver?
2006.
Okay. That's okay. Now, the biggest question I have for you, because you didn't mention it once in your entire story, is when did your husband get killed?
The exact date, I cannot recall. It was beginning of May of 2016. It was not November.
Okay. So sometime, you don't know, but sometime in May of 2016 is when this happened. Okay. Now, your phone number prior to this homicide was 352-431-0419, correct? You don't know your phone number?
That's not my phone number now.
Okay. You don't?
I do not recall my
phone. Okay. But if those are the, if that's the phone number that is from all those screenshots between you and Jereme Townsend that you saw,
yes.
Would that refresh your memory that that was your phone number?
Yeah.
Okay. And you, at some point, changed your number to 352-431-8444, correct?
I can't recall that because at some point I put my parents on my phone line.
You remember seeing the court document that was submitted into evidence where you put your address and phone number on it?
Yes.
Okay. And that 844
okay.
number
yeah.
was what you listed.
Yeah. I don't remember the phone numbers from back then. And since then, I have also had my parents on my phone bill.
My question was whether or not that was your phone number. You agree that the 8444 number was your phone number based on that court document?
Yes.
You would have been truthful in a court document, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Now, I also, one of the statements that you made, I think you said you wouldn't recognize Jereme.
Today, when he walked in, I would have never recognized him today. That's not what he looks like.
All right. Now, you mentioned the fact that he had this skull tattoo. You have a skull tattoo, too, right? All right. So that doesn't really mean anything.
Well, I had mine way before.
Okay. Now, you were saying that you met Jereme Townsend in August of 2015.
Yes, at the end of August.
And that he passed you some sort of post-it note.
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
Yep.
All right. And you had talked about because you had marks on your face or something like that. Is that a yes?
Yes.
All right. Now, according to you, Michael Shaver had left the residence in November of 2015, correct? Your residence.
Yes.
All right.
I had kicked him out.
All right. Well, I thought that you were the type of person that would just shut down and retreat and couldn't confront anybody. That was your words, right?
No, I said that I'm not the type of person where if you come at me and say something, like belittling me or anything like that, I shut down and retreat. I'm not confrontational.
All right.
And that was in the context of me and my daughter.
But you can't. But you were confrontational with Mike Shaver.
Yeah, I told him to get out because he okay. knew that if I called the cops and he would definitely be kicked out and he would be picked up. So
all
yes,
right.
It was very pretty much easy to get him out.
Let's try to figure out this timeline. Then. In September of 2014, he was arrested for a domestic incident that involved you. Correct.
Correct.
And that is when he went to the airport hangar. Correct, where he started living.
Yes.
All right. Did he move back into the house after that?
Yes.
All right. When did that happen?
I don't know the exact time.
Okay.
It was.
How long had
he
been gone?
He had been gone over a year.
All right. So sometime in 2015.
Mm-hmm. It was, yeah, probably summer 2015.
Okay. So if the arrest was in September of 2014, approximately 6 to 8 months that he was gone?
No, it was greater than that because he had finished his probation period.
Okay. And in that incident, he also suffered injuries, correct?
Yes.
Because you hit him over the head with a gun, correct?
Well, he had the gun pointed at my head, and at that point, I was done. I thought I was giving up at that point. I had nothing left in me until I seen my kids come out and start screaming. And as soon as I seen them, I took and slammed that gun into his head.
Yes. Okay. Have you ever told anyone that he was not at fault for that incident and this is actually you?
No.
Did you throw a vase of flowers into the sliding glass door and break that?
I did.
Can we approach, please?
Sidebar, please.
during that incident, did you throw a vase breaking the sliding glass door? Okay. And you also broke objects in the bathroom, correct?
No, I did not.
Okay. There's pictures of the sliding glass door from that incident. You've seen those, correct?
Yes.
And other items in the house that were broken, correct?
Correct.
Along with the injuries to you and the injuries to Mr. Shaver.
The only injury that I was aware of was to his head.
Okay. And his pants were torn, correct?
He would hold my keys in his pants and would not let me leave the residence. So after I hit him in the head, pushed the gun into his head, I had to reach into his pocket and grab my truck keys so that I could evade the property with my children and get to safety.
Now, after he left in November of 2015.
Okay.
Got it straight now? Okay. After he left in November of 2015, was this incident, which ultimately led to his death, the first time that he came back?
Yes, it was.
Okay. So then in August, I'm sorry, you're saying you actually started a relationship with Jereme Townsend in August of 2015?
We started talking in August. And Michael was still at the residence.
Okay. So after November of 2015, he does not come back to the house.
Correct.
So that check that was sent to him and deposited in his account, he would not have received, correct?
I don't know. He got his mail.
How did he get his mail if he wasn't at the house?
The mailbox was not at my residence. It was at the end of the road.
Okay, so after he left in November of 2015, are you saying that he would just come by every day to pick up his mail?
I don't know what he did.
Did you ever notice any mail missing?
How would I know if it was missing?
Did you ever notice any of your stuff missing?
No. Did he
did you ever notice any mail coming for Michael Shaver to that address after he left?
Yes, a few things.
What would you do with that in order to get it to him?
I would take it back to the post office and do return mail, no longer at this address.
Where was it going?
I don't know.
Where was he?
I don't know. I assumed at the probably back at the hangar.
If he left in November of 2015 and went to go live at the hangar, why would he quit his job at Disney?
Because there was a sexual harassment charge against him.
You heard that his supervisor came in and said there was no such thing and there's nothing in those records, correct?
Oh, I did. Right. I heard that.
Are you saying that Disney falsified those records?
The sexual harassment complaint filed against him came directly from Michael's mouth.
Okay. And you had access to his bank accounts, correct?
Yes, he had access to mine as well.
And you withdrew money from his accounts, correct?
And deposited money, correct.
All right. In November of 2015, what deposits were you making in his account?
I have no idea. I'm
Did
not sure that
you
I
deposit
was.
Deposit that Mariner check into his account?
No. I have no idea what that is.
All right. The money from the sale of all of his property, how did you get that to him?
Well, it was not necessarily his property.
Okay,
it was on
his guns.
Okay, so after he was arrested and...
My question was, how did you get the money from the sale of his guns to him if you didn't know where he was?
I did not give him the money from the sale of the guns. Those were not his guns.
Would you have any way, if you say you don't even know where he is, would you have any way of getting him any of that money?
No, I never said I gave him money.
You just said you deposited money into his account.
No, I mean, that was throughout the whole marital, I would deposit money and take out money. He worked overnights. So during the day, if he needed anything, any shopping and all of that for the well-being of the house and the kids, I would do that during the day because he was sleeping because he worked overnights.
As far as the Facebook records, all the stuff from the Laurie Shaver Facebook account, you would agree you posted, correct? None of that stuff was anybody hacking you or anything like that?
Did not appear so.
And you had access to Michael Shaver's Facebook, correct?
Previously.
Okay. How did you have access to his account?
well, previously we had a joint account. After we had separated in 2014, I believe we separated emails, Facebook. Prior to that, everything was joint. After that, we went from a joint bank account to two bank accounts, two emails, two Facebooks. Prior to that, everything was joint because he controlled everything.
Did you have his password?
Previously, well, it was a joint password because it was a joint account.
When he had his own, when did he start his own account?
After we had separated in 2014.
Did you have his password for that account?
Well, that was our account.
When you said he started his own account, my question is, all right. And did you ever post anything on his account?
No, I did not.
Did your daughter have his password?
I don't believe so.
Was anyone else living in your house after May of 2016 that had access to his phone or password for Facebook?
I don't know about the password, but there was two tablets. There was a laptop and a desktop.
Did they have his Facebook profile in it?
Well, everything was automatic. Everything was already logged in, so all you had to do was just log it, like open it up, and you were automatically logged in.
Was your daughter posting on his Facebook?
No.
Was your son posting on his Facebook? Oh. Now, did you ever tell anyone that after he left in November of 2015 that he was in jail for failing to pay child support?
I did.
That wasn't true, correct?
No, it was not. That was an old manager that I had a relationship with way back when, and he had moved back from Connecticut to Florida and was reaching out to me, and he was curious.
Okay. That's Jereme, correct?
Correct.
And when you say relationship, that's another affair, correct?
Right.
But you told him that Mike was in jail for failing to pay child support and his license was suspended, correct?
I gave him my personal information, and he was asking about that because...
Okay, wait, hold on one second. How is Mike being in jail your personal information?
Accurate personal information, because he was questioning. Because prior to that, there was conversations where Michael had threatened once again, after finding out, to kill me.
All right. So when you told your manager that you had a prior affair with that Mike was in jail, that was a lie. Did you tell your sister that you guys had been working out a separation agreement?
Yes. Well, we actually did work out a separation agreement, and it was filed with the court.
In order to do that, you have to get was that here in Lake County?
It was.
Okay, so there is some sort of divorce proceeding with your name on it and Michael Shaver's because you just said you filed something in court, correct?
I did not say divorce. You said separation. So after 2014, after that incident, we both had attorney representation, and Michael and I came up with an agreement, handwritten. We both signed it. That was filed.
Where?
Here.
Where?
At this courthouse.
What case is that in?
Whatever the prior DCF is, and I had won that case with no adjudication. I don't know where that record is, but it was filed. And in that agreement, he agreed to pay X amount of money. I would keep the kids. He could not take the kids. He would see them every other weekend, whatever. We had that separation. I made more money than he did. I covered the health insurance. I covered the kids. I kept the house. He was moving out of the house, and he was going to pay XYZ. That was a handwritten document that both of us signed in front of the mediator at this DCF agreement that I won with no adjudication.
Was there ever a divorce proceeding started?
No, there was not. Not in the state of Florida.
After 2015, was there ever a divorce proceeding started?
No.
When law enforcement came and asked you about the whereabouts of your husband, you were not truthful with them, correct?
I didn't know where he went. Mm-hmm.
You know what happened to him, correct?
Yeah.
All right, you didn't tell him that, correct?
Sure.
The Walmart purchase that was on your husband's bank account. You did that, correct?
I don't recall doing that.
That was sent to your house with your name on it, correct?
Yeah. All right. I don't recall, like, the exact parameters around it or what I bought or anything like that.
So this event happens in May of 2016, correct? Say yes?
Yes.
Your relationship with Jereme Townsend ends very tumultuously in May of 2016, correct? Mm-hmm. Say yes?
Yes.
And your relationship with Travis Filmer then begins in May of 2016, correct?
He came over at the end of May, yes.
And you were actually engaged to him in July of 2016, correct? In April of 2016, Rebecca Urbanowski was living with you, correct?
Right.
And the fire pit itself was built in March of 2016?
I guess so. I don't
know. That's when you posted it, right?
Yeah.
And then how big was your property?
5 acres.
And out of all of that land, you just happened to choose the area where your dead husband's body was found to put that cement slab. That's basically what you're saying here, correct?
No, because I did not know his body was there. It went there because that area was already dug out.
Quite a coincidence, you'd agree, correct?
No, not necessarily. Not if you realize the whole parameters of what came first and how that all transpired. Like I said, that was supposed to, that was something that Jereme and I had originally talked about doing because I had gotten rid of the animals and we had the fire pit and we were talking about wanting to, I mean, it was his suggestion to put in concrete.
So the March 2016 is when you put that fire pit in and 2 months later is when your husband is killed on your property, correct?
Yes. But the concrete was not poured until September.
Correct, by you and your now husband.
Yes, but I had no knowledge that he was under there. If I was trying to cover him up, why would I do that so many months later? And only...
I haven't asked you a question, ma'am. So, the incident that led to your husband's death, your husband had not been around for months, correct?
Correct.
And he just happens to show up sometime in May of 2016, correct?
Not just happened. That was pretty typical of him being gone for months and then showing up and us getting back together.
Okay.
That was.
And then during that time frame, this was sometime before you were going to take your kids to school, correct?
Yes, it was. He was out on the porch when I went.
How was he dressed?
Shirt,
okay. And an argument between the two of you starts.
Yes, I went outside. I got the kids settled and I went outside to talk to him.
How old was your daughter at this point?
7.
And is there a reason why you never taught your daughter how to dial 911?
I mean, we just had cell phones. We didn't have a landline. She knew how to dial 911, but like I said, I had my cell phone on me. The security system that we had, she would have not have been able to reach. It was above the keys where the door was.
But when she said, I didn't know how to call 911, I'm asking why you wouldn't have taught her.
I did teach her how to call 911, but she didn't have a phone.
Okay. Now, your testimony is that she shot him, correct?
Yes.
And at that point, that you were able to get out from underneath Mr. Shaver, correct?
I did not crawl away until he was falling to the ground. After she shot him, I was still looking at her, like, still comprehending everything that was happening. I wasn't too yet. Because he had his foot on my face, smushing it into the ground. It took me, I mean, it wasn't that long, but it took me a little bit to kind of comprehend what was occurring. And
certainly then, didn't get up after being shot, correct?
Hmm.
He certainly didn't get up out of the chair after being shot, correct?
No, not until, no, no. The after the second shot, he fell forward. The first shot, he sat in the chair.
At the time of his death, Mike Shaver was about 5'3".
5'3"?
Mm-hmm.
5'8", 5'10".
Okay. Now, the...
I'm 5'2".
The probable cause affidavit around the time of his arrest listed him at 5'3" and 130 pounds. You're saying that's inaccurate?
That was probably me.
Okay, were you weren't arrested, right?
His probable cause from 2014?
Yes. You're saying that 5'3 and 130 pounds is inaccurate, is what you're saying?
Yes, that's okay. Definitely probably not what's on his driver's license. He was not 5'3". He was like 5'8 and 150, 160 pounds. I was 5'2 and 115, 20.
When Mike left, he left his vehicle, correct?
You're talking about the black car.
No, I'm talking about he had a vehicle and he left it behind, correct?
His black car had been sitting there for a while. He had a bent rim and the air in the tire could not stay inflated. So he was driving my truck back and forth to work.
Right. My question was, when he left and moved out, he left his car, correct?
He did.
And
he left everything that he had that had any sort of value that could be sold. Correct? His guns,
he took
his
tools,
yeah. His ATV, left all that behind.
Well, all the tools that were in the shed were of no use to him. They were like old tools and stuff like that, and it wasn't an ATV.
My question was, he left the stuff behind, stuff that he could have sold, correct?
Correct.
He stopped going to work and lost his job because of it, correct?
I was not aware of that at that time.
So he lost his ability to make any money, correct?
I was not aware of that at that time.
Prior to November of 2015, he would call you using the phone frequently, correct?
Yes, because he was back in the house and we were working things, trying to work things out.
After November of 2015, there is absolutely no calls to you after that November 7th, 2015, correct?
I don't recall.
There's not a single call to you, to the children, anything, correct?
I don't recall.
There's no activity on his bank other than withdrawals from the ATM in Claremont where you live, correct?
I wouldn't know that.
November 2015, he just vanishes off the face of the earth. No one can account for him, correct?
I don't believe that's true.
But there is, you've definitely not had any contact with him in any ways until he shows up someday, which you do not know, in May of 2016 when this incident occurs, correct?
No, he showed up prior to May.
I asked
my property, but he was already causing trouble prior to that, which fits within his history of doing this.
After you kicked him out in November of 2015, and prior to him coming up the day that he was killed, I asked you, did he ever come, have any contact with you? You said no, correct?
Not physically, correct. But calls and stuff like that, yes.
Calls?
Texts, his threats, stuff like that.
You saw the phone records, which show absolutely no
text,
calls
Facebook
from him
messages,
after November 7th, correct?
All right,
he was
allow the witness to finish. Thank you.
He was communicating with Jereme. I believe he had sent me text. He had sent me a nasty text prior to that, telling me I was just like my mom, something to that effect. He was communicating.
From your IP address?
I don't know that that's my IP address. How can you verify that?
Because it's the same IP address that your account that you says you used posted on as well.
Okay, how do we know that he didn't post on my log into my Facebook?